Hi, folks. I'm Timothy Harvey with SciFiForMe.com, and this is TARDIS Sauce. And as always, I am joined from the gentleman from Traveling the Vortex, Glenn Bartlett.
As always, good to be here.
Sean Collins.
I don't know if it's as always, but I'm okay today.
Well, good, I guess. I mean, enthusiasm.
Such a chore for me to show up and talk about Doctor Who.
Sorry to put you out. Jeez. It's good to have you guys here with me. So tonight we are going to talk about, how do we want to put this? Sean, it was your idea.
The line from the 50th anniversary, the one who forgets and the one who regrets. And that got me to thinking, what are the moments in the very long life of the Doctor that he regrets? I mean, obviously, the moment was kind of a big one. A little bit, again, a big one. throughout the long history of the show, which ones do we think were genuinely the most impactful? I mean, some of them he probably could have brushed off and legitimately forgotten about, in the case of Zoannan, and some of them... maybe not so much. Some of them, I think he's still carrying around with him. Discuss.
You could almost start at the beginning. I mean, leaving Susan behind. And I think that, I mean, to some degree, there's that, of course, the great First Doctor's speech about, you know, go live your life and be happy. And, you know, one day I will return. 50 plus years later. One day has not come, and I think
that, on television.
Fair enough. It has definitely happened in the other media. There have been novels. There has been
there's a big Finnish audio too.
Right. I was thinking for some reason I want to think that there was another audio, but that may be part of the Unbound series. I think going back, and it would be probably an alternate version of Susan. And I, you know, personally, I think they've really missed some opportunities to come back to Susan, both in the tail end of Matt Smith and the tail end of Capaldi. I think they really could have given some fans some, like, really just an amazing moment to bring that back around. But considering how much, especially in the last few years, we've had the Doctor talking about his family or her family. You know, the impact that they're not there anymore. And yet we've got some of the Doctor's family out there, you know, accessible in time and space. I mean, there's Susan, there's Jenny, there's these kinds of family for the Doctor.
There's a brother in alternate media as well. So, I mean, that's quasi-canon.
Yeah, so it's, I mean, I think that's... I mean, clearly the Doctor's family still weighs on the Doctor. And so that, you know, leaving Susan behind and choosing to leave Susan behind, I think whether it's a big thing, I think it's definitely carried through, especially in the new series, that the leaving behind of the family, whether it was by choice or by, you know, well, by choice, period, because the decision to use the moment or to believe that the Doctor used the moment, you know, was certainly a bit of a, the Doctor was going to have family on Gallifrey, in theory, yeah. Right?
In theory, yeah. You know. I would agree that, I agree 100% with you, Tim. I think that the only thing I would depart from is I don't think that it, and I know this isn't certainly just regrets, but I don't think the Doctor regrets leaving Susan, but I do certainly think that's a moment that impacted him in the rest of his life and her life. I think the Doctor continues to remember her. He continues to, you know, that weighs heavy on him, the fact that this was essentially his first traveling companion. This is, if you were to believe the TV series so far, this is the companion that he left Gallifrey with. And so I think that left a huge impact on his life. And I think you're right. All of the people that he left behind to take the life of a traveler that he did, and to continually not, you know, by will and by purpose, not going back to Gallifrey when possible, I think that that certainly does weigh on him as a character. And I think that that, that is what has kind of been the driving point of the character for all these years, is the fact that he's left something behind that he was ashamed of, or he was embarrassed for, or he didn't agree with, or the principles were wrong, or the politics were wrong, you know, in any number of things that they visited. And so certainly I agree that that, that element of it is a huge impact on the Doctor and his character, his her character.
It's definitely a two-pronged approach. Something that I never really thought about watching the classic series, because I grew up with Tom Baker. Tom always had a very disdainful opinion of Gallifrey. They were meddlers. They were in the way. There was politics, you know. And so that's kind of how I looked at Gallifrey. It was just, yeah, we're glad to be out of here. And it wasn't until later on, when you get into the David Tennant, the Matt Smith run, and they're gone, the adage, you don't know what you've got until it's gone, really does kick in. And it becomes a matter of, he became winsome and wistful about home. He became very nostalgic about home. And the different performances, I think, were kind of very clever in a way, in addition to the writing, to be able to bring that out. So I definitely think leaving Gallifrey was a regret. As far as Susan goes, something that we've kind of joked about when we went back through our watch of some of the early Hartnells, mm-hmm. there's a distinct character difference in the Doctor from when he travels with Susan to when he travels without Susan. He's much lighter and funnier and quippy without Susan. He's very somber and serious and grumpy with Susan. And this is total headcanon for me, but it's obviously fan retconning, that he can't be the traveler he necessarily wants to be because he has family with him that he's concerned about. Mm-hmm. He can't go running about and dash into danger because his granddaughter's with him. And so the opportunity, it's not that he dumps her on the first planet that comes along, but there was an opportunity there that he saw. She has this relationship that is burgeoning, and, you know, she can be a leader here and kind of help take charge of the rebuilding of Earth. And he knows Earth. He knows that she'll be relatively safe there, although I don't know what gave him that idea, because we only get invaded every other week. And, he just decided that he's going to leave her there so that he can go become the traveler that he wants to be. Does he regret doing that? I don't think so. Does it stay with him? Is it a moment that it impacted him? Yes. I think that's something that he carries with him every day.
I think there's a lot of that there. I think that it's might just be headcanon, but it's headcanon that fits the evidence. I think that there's an element of selfishness that has always been with the Doctor that actually fits into as well. Mm-hmm. That I can't be the me I want to be if I'm looking after you. And for especially in the last several years, most actually, probably from about 10 and on, the moments of the Doctor's little, his flaws, his selfishness that pop up from time to time. And bite him hard a lot. I think that definitely fits into that in not necessarily a particularly awful way. I mean, it's a very, I want to say human, emotion to have, but it's an understandable one.
I really want to go explore this city, so I'm going to remove the mercury fluid link from the TARDIS and, oh, Daleks, That never comes back to bite you in the butt.
No. Doctor's actions have never come back to bite the Doctor or the Doctor's companions or any planet lurking around in the background, just minding its own business. Except every time that it does. So, and I think that, the character, the companion deaths in the original series tended to be, we talked about this on the last episode that we recorded for TARDIS Sauce, the tendency of how programming worked is that you had the tragic character death or the tragic important character, whether it's a companion of the Doctor or not, that impacted on one of the companions, or it was the death of a companion or something like that. But because the way programming worked in those days, the way TV was, the next set of episodes roll around and nobody talks about it.
Yeah, you're moving on. Yeah, absolutely.
There's no long-term consequence or long-term repercussions or long-term emotional damage. Whereas now, of course, we have that play out over entire seasons.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and not to that drastic effect, but I think I've always admired the fact that they at least, you know, while after Adric's death, we certainly picked back up and just went on. But there is the beginning of the next episode, which I can't remember what follows Earthshock, but it is addressed, you know, the fact that Adric's gone. There's the moment about the bedroom and things like that. And then revisiting that to a slight degree in Caves of Adrazani when he's regenerating and succumbing to the poison, and he sees Adric and he calls out for him. I think that's one of those moments where they did the right thing by not just sweeping it away and saying, okay, that happened, you know, earlier this season or two, three months ago. And so it might've been time flight.
I think of all the things to remember time flight for.
It would have been. And so I appreciated the fact that they do that. And so it does lend to that, you know, it certainly left a mark and they didn't ignore it. They certainly didn't go to the extreme of continuing to drag it out or continuing to revisit it as they have in the new series. But at least in Classic Who, you can say, look to that and say, yeah, at least they did show that there was some lasting effect on from Adric's death.
Well, I think in some respects, Adric's death still remains a death that didn't have to happen. It wasn't the kind of, you know, Clara made the series of choices that led to the alleyway and the Raven. Bill was just an accident. That's the recent deaths we have. You know, Rory was killed off for comic relief, and so that he could become plastic and save the universe. But Adric's death, for all that Adric was a character who the writers never quite got right. Mm-hmm. The death was an avoidable death. It was not a death where, you know, gross negligence or gross stupidity it was just one of those deaths that little decisions became him being stuck there.
Right. Right,
you know, and in character decisions for Adric kept him stuck there.
Right, and somewhat some nobility, maybe a little bit of stubbornness, and maybe even I don't want to say I don't want to cheapen the death by saying that, you know, he didn't have to stay in order to try to figure those calculations out, but it is a bit noble that he did, thinking that he could stop the catastrophe from happening, and that's why he ends up staying behind. But I agree. It's certainly not a. It certainly is just situational for that particular death.
In retrospect, I mean, when you consider, you know, James T. Kirk never said another word about Edith Keeler the entire run of the Star Trek series, or in any film after.
Yeah.
And you know,
that's because Spock made him forget.
Yeah, but
the audience doesn't forget.
No, in fact, one of my big complaints about Generations is when Kirk is in the Nexus and it's his fantasy world. It should have been Edith Keeler was this mystery woman. But
I agree.
That's a different topic for a different podcast.
That would have been amazing.
What about moments that don't involve death? I think one of the things that probably impacted him, and there is just that special moment that Tom gives us at the as she's walking away, it would be Romana 2 specifically, when she's left with the thralls, during Warrior's Gate, and that kind of second glance that he takes at the end. Mm-hmm. And I think that the heart-wrenching part of that isn't the fact that she stayed behind. It's the fact that they had finally developed such a relationship. And I think he was also at a point where he was finally traveling with somebody that was, you know, at some time, or at least on the same level, and sometimes maybe even a higher level than the Doctor in some ways. And so I think that probably leaves a bit of an impact on the Doctor of, you know, on the heels of that, then we get Leela, which is going to be, well, we went, yeah, that's right. And then,
backwards.
Yeah, that would have been, so who would have been after?
Leela, then Romana two, then the Adric.
Yes, that's right. Adric stayed on with him.
Adric and
Nyssa.
Yeah. So, and you could argue that Nyssa, I don't think she's on the same level as the Doctor, but she certainly was a formidable companion as far as intellect and Adric to a point. I mean, he's, for being a young man of 15, he was a smart kid. You got to give him that. But I don't think he ever met an equal again for a long time at the very least. And so certainly I think that leaves an impact on you as well, that you're traveling somebody that might be just sort of on the same wavelength as you, at least intellectually, and maybe even the fact that she is a fellow Time Lord. And so there's a bit of familiarity there as well.
Well, I think that there's a fragility to the human companions that the Doctor references, especially in the new series, you know, how living forever, you know, is watching everybody else die. And for a while there, he was traveling with someone, he didn't have to worry about that. She had the same backup system that the Doctor has.
Right.
You know, the same ability to dive into danger without going, oh crap, we broke the human. which, you know, I think they the new series addresses quite a bit. It, you know, shows the fragility of, you know, not only our physical fragility, but also our fragility of our mental states, our relationship with other people. You know, they dive into that in a way they never did in the original series. Not to mention, of course, it's the chemistry at that particular point between Tom Baker and Lala Ward that had that, you know, that they on, you know, behind the scenes things, not so much, but on camera, they had such great chemistry. They felt like, it felt like a much more, I don't want to necessarily say joyful period of the Doctor's life, but certainly a happier period, a certain more, you know.
Maybe even a more relaxed.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, more of a, less of the worry or the concern and more of a relaxed, this is the kind of adventures we can have because I have somebody on kind of on the same level as me. As you said, without the fragility of you know, death, or, you know, there is a backup, that kind of thing. So,
to play devil's advocate, how much of that was the inclusion of Douglas Adams as showrunner? That it was a happier time.
Well, maybe that could be too. And arguably, there were times on screen where you could tell when Tom and Lala were getting along, and you could tell there were times when they weren't getting along. I think that came through as well. But yeah, overall, it seemed like a more relaxed atmosphere.
Which, you know, actually ended up working for the characters because you put more than one Time Lord in a room, and there seems to be a certain amount of grr. Yeah. they don't work in large groups. They tend to do bad things. In large groups, Time Lords are, you know, I don't know, you want to be around a group of Time Lords. It doesn't seem safe.
I'm always impressed whenever we get a multi-doctor story, simply from the standpoint that all of those egos on screen at the same time, and yet they still seem to find a way to make that work.
Well, I think it was during the 50th that, you know, Matt Smith's Doctor says, this is what it's like. This is what it's like when I'm alone.
Was it, are you thinking of Power of Three where he says, is this like what it's like when time moves normally?
That too. Yeah. And of course we can't get around the fact that, you know, the Doctor believed he destroyed his own people. That's probably, you know, that's obviously the big one. And, I mean, you know, he not only committed genocide, he committed genocide not by accident. Spoiler alert for anyone who hasn't seen the last several years, the doctor did not in fact kill his own people.
There's less than a 10-year moratorium on that. I think we're safe.
Saying, don't want to surprise anybody out there. But the conscious decision to do, you know, even to save the universe. I mean, because it literally is the kind of choice where you're making, you know, how many billions, trillions, you know, of lives are you saving? You know, on a far greater scale than that. I mean, by killing, you know, billions of people, but they're your own people. I mean, there's so many different things that if you think about it, it's such a nightmare.
Mm-hmm. Well, and tied in with that, I think you have to go back to Genesis. You have to look at Genesis of the Daleks, which a lot of fandom has kind of, you know, retconned to be the first shot fired in the Time War, mm-hmm. and right. It was the Time Lords who did it. But for the Doctor to have that crisis of conscience, that great moment with the wires, and do I have the right, and ultimately decide not to do it, and then know every time he comes up against the Daleks, every single time he sees somebody get evaporated, that in a way it's his fault.
Mm-hmm.
That all of that building up over the years, over the decades, over the millennium, when you finally get to the Time War, how much did that weigh into that decision? How much did that impact him that because of this decision, I'm not going to shirk it and I'm going to do it this time?
Yeah. Well, and that feeling didn't go away. I mean, he never lost that feeling after the fact either, because, you know, you get to, what is it, a town called Mercy.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, how many times has my choice to give some, you know, to apply mercy to my enemies has made more death happen? And, you know, that comes back to we've talked about this some in the past, is the Doctor carries on a ridiculous amount of guilt. Some of it deserved. You know, for good and for ill, we make those decisions. But an objective viewer is going to sit there and say, yes, by not destroying the Daleks, many people died. You made a great ethical choice.
Well, and that comes back around again, too, in the new series when the 13th Doctor lets Timshaw go. That ends up, we get another situation where she has shown some amount of a mercy, and it has come back to kind of bite her in the end. And so I think that becomes a continuing theme. And yeah, it certainly does go all the way back to Genesis. I want to point out too that the real tragedy of the really affecting of the Doctor's character, I think, does come in the new series, because not only is he dealing with the fact that the result of the Time War in the moment, but following that, he has at least the first on-air romance with a companion and ends up losing her to a sealed-off alternate dimension, an alternate universe.
Point of order, are we not including Grace in this discussion?
So there's that, and then now Grace chose to leave behind. That's a non-issue.
First romantic.
No, I don't think that was romantic. That kiss was platonic. So, but no, a relationship that's developed. I mean, yeah, sure, he may have had feelings for Grace, and Grace may have had feelings for him, and just because they shared the same on-screen kiss, it wasn't the same time to develop a relationship as it right. was with Rose. So,
okay.
So yes, we'll skip over that. But on top of that, then after he loses her, they just continue to pile on. He has the situation with Donna, where she's forced to forget him, everything that they did together, their relationship, their friendship, everything that they got. On top of that, when he decides to be, you know, Time Lord triumphant and rescue the astronaut lady, Waters of Mars, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
He decides he's going to change time and he's going to, you know, rescue her and the other two. And on, you know, and then for her to end her life because she knows, you know, time has to be set straight, that the record has to be set straight. And so just continually piling moments and moments upon the Doctor. And it's not surprising that we get the one who forgets, which in Matt Smith's era, a lot of that is shoved aside. And he is more of the carefree because he as, you know, stated well in Day of the Doctor, the fact that he does tend to try to forget it. He's trying to put everything behind him. And then I think that culminates in the gruff, grumpy 12th Doctor that we get with Peter Capaldi. So, yeah, there are so many things that affect him in a domino effect leading up to the new series, or the you know, where we're at today.
Yeah, but I know it's a great line, the one that regrets, the one that forgets, but I've always thought that Matt Smith's Doctor was lying when he said that. I think he was just flat out lying to himself in more than one way when he said that line about not remembering. Because we dealt with things like Amy, and we dealt with things like there's the moments in like A Good Man Goes to War, okay? The Doctor's arrogance, the Doctor's anger, the Doctor's the same kind of moments we get in Waters for Mars, only on it's a different scale.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the, you know, time cannot control me. I will the laws of time are mine is different than, you know, Colonel Runaway. But on one level they aren't.
Well,
that same kind of arrogance and, you know, I will make the world obey me in some way that is out of, I can't say it's out of character for the Doctor, because it's not.
Right.
But when he lets that out, when the Doctor releases the arrogance, and we haven't seen that with Jodie. No. We haven't seen that, you know, the moments of the arrogance coming up.
But I don't think he's lying, but I think it's delivered with a bit of poetry. I think that Matt Smith's Doctor did have those moments that you're alluding to. But the thing is, Matt Smith was a lot more laid back and did not let emotion dictate his decisions until he was driven to that point. And so I think it's more poetic that he's saying, you know, that they're saying the one that forgets. It wasn't that he forgot everything that happened. In fact, in the particular episode with House, the Doctor's wife, where House says, you know, fear me, I've killed many Time Lords. And he says, fear me, I killed them all. And so he obviously did not forget.
Well, no, but what I mean is like that moment in, you know, where he's sitting there and, you know, how many people died that day? And he says, I don't remember.
Yeah, no, that's totally a lie.
That was totally a lie.
Yeah,
that's totally a lie.
It's like that whole bit where he's talking about, you know, everything that he's talking about, his lack of, you know, I don't remember. Yeah. And you know, it.
Yeah, no, that's him hiding behind it because of the pain. And
that's
and
exactly
David
why
Tennant's anger.
That's him. That is exactly why he's the one that forgets. That's why poetically he's the one that forgets, because he's trying to forget. He's choosing to forget. And it's because he's been hurt so bad for so many years. For over you know, at least two incarnations of his life, he's been hurt. And so this Doctor's persona or personality is trying to suppress that in order to maybe try to get away from those feelings of regret. And so it's almost a, I'm choosing to forget, not that he actually did forget. And so when he says he doesn't remember how many, he really does.
Yeah.
He's just choosing to forget how many.
I think you go one step further with it. I think it's not so much that he's more laid back and carefree about it and choosing to forget. I think it's one of those things you simply can't. And so
yeah.
The reason that Matt Smith's Doctor is so scatterbrained and so frantically hither and yon is because he's trying to actively do anything he can to not wallow in it.
Yeah, he's
that's why those moments where he does let the demons out of the closet and he snaps and becomes the angry, vengeful Doctor.
It's regression.
It's because
therapy.
It's right there.
Yeah, it's regression therapy is what it is. Yeah,
and I think it also, I mean, it plays out very much so that for being the youngest actor to play the part, you so often came across as an incredibly old man.
Yeah, I agree.
I mean, the way he carried himself, the way that, you know, it was really impressive to me just how much he could make you feel like he was 1,000 years old. Mm-hmm. Just by, you know, the way he took in a breath before he said a line. And then followed by an actor who is what he and he's the same age as William. He was the same age taking
the same William age Hartnell was, William right? Hartnell when he took over as the doctor.
Peter Capaldi, yeah.
Well, Peter Capaldi
are the two oldest actors to begin playing the part at that age.
That's correct.
And yet there, and for all of that, there were many, many moments, especially once, you know, the guitar came out, that Capaldi was very childlike.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you know, for all he could be incredibly serious and incredibly old, there were these brief moments of the doctor's inner, you know, let's run and play.
It was, you're absolutely right. It was the exact reverse of Matt Smith. Matt Smith was a young doctor that had glimpses of the old man. And Capaldi was the older doctor with a lot of glimpses of the young man. And I think that was well played by both.
Where do we think Sarah Jane falls on this list? I mean, obviously for fans, she's a huge impact. And yet for the doctor, the loss of Sarah Jane, the fact that she leaves him, basically because he forces her out of the TARDIS, maybe because of his feelings about Gallifrey, maybe not. I don't believe that there was some silly rule about no Earthlings allowed. I think once again, I think it's a Susan situation. Yeah. I mean, well, she technically wasn't an Earthling. Well,
she was a descendant.
But, you know, I totally think it was a Susan situation. I think he was leaving her behind because he didn't know what he was going into.
Yeah.
And didn't want to worry about her. But is that something that all these years later, is he still carrying around that?
No, because there's some resolution in School Reunion. I think that's one of those unique brief moments where he gets to put some closure on the situation. So yes, I think that was highly impactful and affected him for many, many years, until in his 10th incarnation, he was allowed to bring some closure to that when she returns, you know, and they end up, you know, finding each other again. I think because that gave us some closure, I don't think that's something that he carried beyond that. I think that was enough for him, especially the way that beautiful scene where he embraces her at the end, you know, my Sarah Jane, and just hugs her. And I still get chills thinking about it because it just was one of those moments that just, I was like, oh, such great closure. And so I think that's one of the things that, yes, I think it certainly did impact him. I think it was something he regretted, but he was fortunately in this situation, had the chance to put some closure on it.
You know what I wish we'd gotten and we didn't, and I don't think we'll ever get it, because it would have to be written so well and performed so well. But it's called it's called a walk and talk in TV and cinema terms. It's basically somebody moving along, having a conversation. The camera stays with them the entire way. I would love to have the doctor just going along, talking to a companion, and telling them about the people that traveled with them before. Just a sentence about every single one of them. You could do it it would have to be done. So well. It almost completely different tone, but it would have to be on the same level as Capaldi's war speech. Because, I mean, that's 10 minutes of dialogue. And it's almost all him.
Yeah.
And that's so dark and tragic, but it could be so much fun and light and glimmering moments of tragedy for the companions who have died. Mm-hmm. But can you just imagine just one amazing little just, oh, so who's traveled with you before? Well, let's see. There was my granddaughter, Susan. And, you know, and just, again, it would come down to some amazing writing. And an amazing performance, which the show does from time to time. Enough that we can talk about these great moments all the time. But because we have these little moments where we tie continuity together. You know, when the Eighth Doctor's, when parts of the Eighth Doctor's audio continuity becomes canon, you know, and companions are named. Companions the TV audience has never heard of in a lot of cases. You know, I don't know. It's that kind of thing, because we know the companions overall, in a broad sense, the companions have an incredible impact on the Doctor. Whether it's for losing them or just enjoying their time together. Mostly, you know, we hear about the ones that we've lost in some sort of tragedy. But wouldn't it just be great to have a moment where he just talks about a little bit of joy about, and then there was that Australian, you know, and it just, you know.
Well, it could be very therapeutic for the Doctor.
Yeah. So I don't know. I mean,
I've just solved your problem, Tim. That's a great solution for a regeneration sickness episode.
Yeah, because you wouldn't have the typical tropes of the generation sickness. You would have, it wouldn't be, you know, weird mood swings or attacking companions or, you know, sleeping for most of the episode until, you know, you're infused by coffee or tea. But yeah, that certainly would be a different spin on the regeneration recovery.
The problem is that means waiting at least a couple more years. I mean, to get that scene. I'm in no hurry to see Jodie go away. So,
unless you believe the rumors, which blah, I don't. Blah, blah,
blah. I've got one more that yeah. It was yet another moment that Matt Smith managed to forget and kind of sweep under the rug. But the phone call that informed him of the death of the brig.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Not only was that, you know, a knife in my heart, but something that the way that Matt's performance plays out, he just put it off too long and he knew it. Yeah. He could have gone and visited at any point in time. Mm-hmm. Literally any point in time, and didn't.
Well, and that's almost one of the tragedies of time travel, is that once you know it's too late, you could go back. You go back and visit him. But he knows he's going back to visit him because he didn't go back to visit him
right
the first time.
And how tainted would that visit be to show up? And it's not so much the knowledge of knowing that this person's going to die. He's lived with that. But the fact that you're now visiting this person that you know has died. In your timeline, they're gone. And how awkward would that make that conversation?
Which is typically something the Doctor doesn't do, because we have, to my knowledge, have never done that before, where we've had a Doctor go back to a point beyond the knowledge of their death. And so there's obviously a reason for that, and it's the fact that how maybe inappropriate that would be for him in his life to go back and revisit, you know, companions or friends that he knows. I mean, he obviously knows they're going to die, but when it becomes a moment or element in his life that the death affects him, and then suddenly it's kind of, you have to put it all in the past, and that's kind of a closed chapter in his life.
And I think the very rare moments where he gets to step outside of that are the moments like with River going to the Singing Towers of Beryllium.
Yeah.
Because...
unique situation, too.
They knew it was coming, but they didn't know how it was going to happen.
Going back to visit Rose before she became a companion.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sort of thing. I mean, those moments really play well. Well, unfortunately, we are out of time. I think we probably have gone over, and that's okay. I don't mind. It's a self-imposed 30-minute guideline. Don't care. But yeah, and we could and there's a lot more we could talk about. I mean, it's, you know, there's... not only in there's still stuff in the TV side of things that we could talk about, but there's certainly stuff in the book lines, there's stuff in the audio lines, there's a ton of stuff in the Virgin line where they really dive into this sort of thing with the Doctor.
Yeah, we haven't touched on the Seventh Doctor at all.
I mean, the death of Roz Farrister in the Virgin line is a huge, huge thing. Yeah. And that's with the most manipulative version of the Doctor ever put to print. And so there's a lot more we could talk about. And we probably should come back and revisit this some other point, because there's a whole bunch of audio stuff and novel stuff we could talk about for a really long time. But, gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you for having us.
Folks, if you, we would love to hear from you, by the way. We put this thing out on YouTube, right? And it's this little, you know, little video platform you may have heard of. below there is a place for comments. Now, I would, of course, ask that you are polite, because, you know, the internet has enough lack of politeness as it is. Agree, disagree with the things that we talk about. We'd love to hear from you. Please be nice to each other. The universe is a much better place if we're a lot less trollish. But we'd love to hear from you guys there. And if you have any questions for us or suggestions about topics, we'd love to hear that as well. Definitely check out these gentlemen's podcast. Traveling the Vortex is a lot of fun, and they have a very long conversations about really cool things. And I was very, very lucky to be on an episode.
Times longer than we intend.
Yeah, it works. And I was so excited. I was very, very happy to be on an episode. So I definitely encourage you folks to.
We were glad to have you too.
My pleasure. Absolutely.
And apparently there's like, I don't know if you guys can hear the sirens coming through in my, there's apparently things going on in my little neck of the woods. So I should probably go anyway.
The overtime limit police are coming for you.
Yes. All right. Thank you guys. And thank you guys for watching. We'll be back next week with more TARDIS sauce.